Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Bullpen. We have a special bullpen today. We're talking with a clinical counselor and therapist. Before I go to him, we are highlighting mental profiles connected to Karenicity. That will be the discussion. Here's a montage. Karenicity.
Go back, listen. I said, excuse me.
Go back.
Where are you from?
Stop being ignorant.
Calling me ignorant?
Oh, yes.
Y'all, all you think this is acceptable? You
can suck
a tree, bitch.
Get off. Move. What are you doing?
You guys think you're so strong and everything. Right? Come on, make a move, dude. Come on.
Sir,
come on.
Time to go.
Come on.
Time to go, sir.
What? Excuse me. What?
Hey, excuse me.
You saw her hit me, though.
Yeah. I got it all on tape. Oh, she bite him.
You're not
gonna
bite me.
Oh, don't.
You know what?
Don't. Get out my face.
Get out of my face.
No, you walked up to me, ma'am. Get out of my face.
Let me pick a jaws.
Now, okay?
Well, good. Get the f- off my property.
Right.
Get the f- off my property. God damn. Come on, give me your phone.
My phone is not recording.
Hey, excuse me.
No, you just assaulted me.
No.
You pushed me. You broke my ankle.
You were rude. You were saying,
shut your mouth, you ugly bitch.
Get the f- out of this world. Get the f- out of this state. Go back to whatever f***ing Asian country you belong in.
Yes, Karenicity is dangerous. To talk more about this disease, we have deemed Karenicity on Indisputable. We have Morris Mosley, clinical counselor, therapist, long, extensive, and reputable career as a counselor, licensed clinical social worker, and the list goes on. Mr. Mosley, welcome to Indisputable. How are you?
I'm fine, Dr. Richey. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for being here. Listen, this is actually a very serious subject because we have seen individuals weaponize their privilege, weaponize their whiteness in order to get other people in major trouble. And sometimes it has resulted in injury. And the most extreme cases, it has resulted in somebody's death. So let me just pose it this way. What in the hell is wrong with these people? Let you answer that.
Well, there isn't a simple answer, but the most direct answer would be fear. Throughout the course of our lives, you know, across our development, we have these critical tasks where we're supposed to learn something that advances us to the next step. Each stage is dependent upon the previous one. So let's suppose I go all the way back to the time where I believed in the tooth fairy.
Yeah.
As life goes on, I begin to understand that the environment is telling me something different. It's telling me the tooth fairy may not be real. Now I have to reconcile either what I believe is true or the environment is true. Most of us can make this adjustment pretty easily and throughout the course of our lives, but not all of us. Let's suppose that what I believe about myself, I hinge to the environment. So if I believe I am superior, I am privileged, the environment has to give me consistent feedback. The dilemma is the environment doesn't do that. So even on the clips, what you saw was a look of desperation. It wasn't just, I'm sharing my opinion. It was, I have to shift yours. So the dilemma here is not that I should even try to change the opinion of the individual. The dilemma is not to let the individual change my opinion. So imagine that what we have is someone who is in conflict with a constant message from the environment that questions who they are. If my belief about who I am is tied to what I believe the environment says, then every time there's an inconsistency, I have to attack it. I have to be able to say, I'm not wrong. Let me correct the environment. So I will come up to people who are doing something that basically expresses a counter to what I believe, and I have to correct them. what you see in the faces of the individuals here, they're determined to change the minds of the people they confront. The fear is that if they are wrong, their identity is now comes into question. If I believe I'm superior, let's say, the environment has to be consistent with that belief. If someone challenges me, I have to correct the environment. So who I am is now at stake. What I believe is true about me is about to be challenged by all of these messages from the environment, just something I don't agree with. So it's a really difficult phenomenon to undo because of the circumstances. What it would take for me to question myself means I first have to have a certain tolerance for being wrong. If I have no tolerance for being wrong, I'll struggle with it. Mm. I really struggle with it.
Let's talk about that. Because what I hear you saying is that in a way they do not have the ability to be self-analytical. They obviously are not as self-aware as required for an adult. How is that dynamic magnified when you live in, let's say, a community or home environment, or maybe even a professional or faith environment that reinforces that bias and protects you from the reality of the fact that you are not superior, but it reinforces your superiority complex? What happens in that environment?
Well, the environment is something that we can't control it. Mm. It makes adjustments as time goes on. There are things we used to believe that we no longer. If I come face to face with an aspect of the environment that's contrary to what I believe, then it's a certain amount of trauma that takes place, because it's not just about an agreement or a disagreement. It's really tied to who I am. So early in life, my parents may have said, this is who you are, before I had my own opinion. At some point in life, I shift that. I say, well, here's what I've learned based on my experience. But if I don't, I hold on to that original belief. And this is what you're seeing in the films. Someone who has held on to a belief that they are superior in some way.
Yeah. Go ahead, sir.
So if I let go of that belief, I'm not talking about now the environment anymore. I'm talking about myself.
Let's talk about nature versus nurture. Obviously, I'm not as trained as you are in this arena. I've taken a couple of psychology classes in my duration as an academic. But I know the concept of nature versus nurture and how in many ways we are supposed to be a combination of experiences, exposures, and environments. So how is it that certain individuals, they can literally receive these cues that the atmosphere is different than their own self-perception, that the atmosphere rejects that they are in fact privileged or somehow more special than anybody else. And they are still, without nurture, they are still engaging in Karenicity. How does that happen when they hit bumps every time they do this? How is it they never change?
Change is really tied to the ability to grow. Mm. So it's not just a shift, it's questioning what I currently believe and then coming up with something that is more consistent with life around me today. So it's more than asking me to change my opinion, it's asking me to change who I am. What's really happened is growth has stopped. See, growth is choice. I can choose to continue to challenge my beliefs, make them consistent with the world around me, or I can choose not to. If I choose not to, then I have to correct the world around me because I'm not changing myself. The dilemma is it creates a crisis. Now it's a matter of desperation to change what I'm seeing that's inconsistent with what I believe. So you could call it a form of arrested development. Children are very concrete thinkers. It's right, it's wrong, it's black, it's white, it's up or down. As we get older, we realize these are extremes. Most of life exists in between. And so it helps us now be flexible as the surroundings change. If I stay in this very concrete mode, it's just win-lose, then it creates a crisis for me. Now I understand that.
You said growth is choice. That is so powerful. Growth is choice. And I agree with you wholeheartedly. Let me highlight something that took place maybe a week or two ago. We did a segment where a known Karen, I'm talking about this person, was very high profile in her Karenicity, in her privilege. She literally did a video and denounced what she previously said, how she previously behaved. And it was the first time that I can remember that somebody who engaged in what I would consider clinical Karenicity looked as if they were changing or had transformed on some level. So the question is Karenicity curable?
Typically, no. There are circumstances where, let's suppose that in the course of my beliefs, as a result of my actions, I cause harm to someone that I care about. It is possible for me to take a different path because that might be the first time I've actually looked at life through someone else's eyes. So the dilemma here is I typically see life through my own. I actually avoid seeing other perspectives because it makes me question my own. But if the result of my behavior affects someone I care about, that actually affects me. So you can change someone's behavior if you can directly affect them. But if the person is highly self-centered, the only one that can do that is themselves. So my behavior, my self-serving interest becomes part of the dynamic. I say or do something, hurt someone I care about. There's no one to blame here. I have to take a look at my intention, how the person received this, and then the guilt or the shame that's attached to it. In those circumstances, I've seen someone who's highly self-centered change their behavior because there was one, it's still self-serving behavior. I want to feel better. Two, I have to somehow exchange my guilt or shame for something more appropriate. And three, there's essentially, I'm locked into this perception that says self-serving behavior is how I get motivated. That's what moves me. My behavior now is to relieve the pain I caused. How do I do that? And so I start to undo those things.
Are Karens born, Mr. Mosley? Are they born or are they developed or combination of both?
First 5 years of our life, we don't have an opinion of ourselves. It's mostly of what our parents think of us. So during that time, my parents could say, you could all but walk on water. Everything you do is perfect, that's right, it's just. Now, at some point, I become influenced by people other than my parents as I get older, and they challenge that. In fact, there's a good chance I might run into somebody whose parents told them the exact same thing. So we both can't get our way. We might have to work together. This is what should happen. We reach a place where we say we're all wanting what we want. Now, if it doesn't happen, it means I have to not continue to correct the environment. But that means I have to deny growth. I have to deny everything that's part of my experience that tells me you might want to challenge what you believe.
This is so rich and informative. What can be done? Let's imagine that a Karen or two, they may actually watch this segment and they would like to be better people. And they realize that they have done some things that are antithetical to the atmosphere around them and they would like to be better. They don't know how to step out of their own Karenism. What can be done? What can they do to help themselves?
There's kind of an acknowledgement that says, I'm about to learn something that I'm not gonna like and it's gonna pinch. And I have to get prepared for the pinch. So it's almost self-talk where I'm saying, I'm about to challenge something I believed all my life. And I'm not gonna like it, but I have to do it anyway. So it's a shift in my own willingness to become more self-aware. But it's typically the result of something that affects me personally that's made me uncomfortable. So the first step, the individual would have to start to pay attention to the level of discomfort. When I'm not able to change my surroundings or people's minds about me, what's left is, could I be wrong? It's not something I want to hear, it's going to pinch, and I have to prepare myself. This is going to hurt, but it might help.
Last question. I created a segment here called Anti-Karens, and it was basically a way to highlight individuals who have effectively disarmed or de-escalated a situation with a Karen. What can we do when we are faced with extreme Karenicity in our everyday lives? What's the best approach?
Probably the best approach is your own self-confidence. See, the individual is trying to change your perspective. And the belief that self-serving says you absolutely have to understand that I am right and you are wrong. So there's that desperation that you see even in the clips, where it's not just me sharing an opinion. I have to change your mind. The less importance I give that effort to change my mind, the more secure in my own opinion I present myself.
Wow.
I'm minimizing that energy that says you have to see it this way. And the response is a loss of self-importance because I didn't take it seriously. The goal is not to change Karen's mind. The goal is to not let Karen change yours.
Man, Mr. Mosley, wisdom, insight, great advice. Dear brother, we appreciate you being on the show and doing this breakdown for us today. So appreciated.
My pleasure.
Absolutely. All right. That was remarkable. Loved it. Okay.